I think one of the issues people have with calling for help maybe is the term itself. It seems so diminishing. So, you know, rather than a black and white moment where we push a button like in a code, I think it's more important to focus on the moments leading up to that big choice, on all the smaller help-seeking behaviors that we can practice throughout an event.
That's interesting. Can you tell me a little bit more about what you mean by help-seeking behavior?
Well, I think we all generally convey receptivity to help through both implicit and explicit behaviors. For example, something as simple as eye contact sends you a message that I'm closed off and in my own world, or open to you speaking up or stepping in to help.
That's a really good point. Sometimes I feel like people might be afraid to show their vulnerability because there might be issues with hierarchy or perceived competence, even across disciplines. So if I am called into a code in another part of the hospital, I'm expected to come in as the expert in the room.
Yeah, but there's many things that you may still need help with, and that doesn't make you weak. For example, if it's a new environment, maybe you don't know where the equipment is, or you need an extra hand stabilizing the airway.
That's true. I do think it's important to be explicit when you're asking for those resources and asking for help early on. Before I go in for an airway, something simple like asking for a suction setup might be helpful. And then if I find out there's a lot of blood or sputum in the airway, I'm all set. Calling for help is not just about saying, I can't do this, or I need somebody else. It's about communicating to optimize our teamwork for the best outcomes.
We hope you keep these examples of calling for help early in mind as you go through the rest of the course. For the next activity, we invite you to watch this scene from our crisis scenario.
See if you can spot the instances where the team is demonstrating the principle of calling for help early.